Okay. Good. And then we're going to do a little bit of the closed caption live transcript here. That should work and come through. All right. Good. It's good to see you. Welcome. Please help me welcome Mr. Paul Epstein. Clapping or thumbs up or whatever you have to signal your appreciation of his time and effort for coming here tonight. We're very lucky to have him with us. I've known Paul for several years, and he always just does a great job. And whatever he's doing, he puts everything into it. I heard that he put a lot into this, and I'm just so excited because this is one of my favorite all-time operas, and I'd like to hear from a professional exactly what he thinks that the libretto, the storyline is telling us. And what and maybe what Mozart was all about with his thinking on that. And so Paul, I'm going to turn this over to you. I'm going to go ahead and put your bio up in the chat for everybody to take a look at, but wanted you to get a chance to have as much time as you need, and unless you get started.
All right, wonderful. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming and for checking out Don Giovanni. It is one of my favorite operas. Perhaps like many of you, I first became aware of it when I watched the movie Amadeus. And there's that striking moment in Amadeus when, as Mozart is dying, here comes this opera, which is also so much about death. Then I went ahead and watched the whole opera. I listened to the whole opera. I studied about the whole opera. But that is certainly what grabbed my attention. A few housekeeping things. If you are unfamiliar with the opera and wish to become familiar with it, I have posted links to two summaries of it in the chat. If you have questions afterwards, I have posted my email address in the chat, pinkyprof@icloud.com. And if you are interested in looking at my slides, I have posted two versions of that into the chat. One is the PowerPoint, and the other is a PDF of the PowerPoint in case one format or the other is more useful to you. As to Steve's interest in knowing what the libretto means and what Mozart was all about, I can say with confidence that I cannot answer that question. The reason being is that a great deal has been said about what the libretto means, and a great deal of conjecture has been expressed about what Mozart intended, much of it contradictory, much of it radically different from the others, much of it from different points of view. Don Giovanni has been considered by opera critics, it has been considered by philosophers, it has been considered by psychologists, it has been considered by sociologists. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. If you do a Google search or you look in your journals database in your library, you will find literally hundreds of sources about Don Giovanni, each one saying a slightly different thing. I have listed the ones that I used, by the way, and a few extra at the very bottom of this PowerPoint. So if there's something that you hear you want to learn more about, you can go ahead and check those out. Today, we are going to look at Don Giovanni from a psychological point of view. And let me just pull up my outline. Okay. You've been looking at the Enlightenment so far, and two values of the Enlightenment are the importance of science and rationality, and also the importance of liberty. Now, one consequence of those values is that Sigmund Freud took them on and decided to understand how the mind works from a scientific point of view. He wanted to understand medically what was wrong with people and how we might best treat them. And following from psychotherapy down several generations of psychologists, we now have modern psychology. Also, given that liberty is now a value in contrast to, say, participation in a particular religious scheme or participation in a particular governmental scheme, that gives us a context to understand Don Giovanni's character. Psychology itself is a big and it's a complicated entity. It runs all the way from Sigmund Freud on the one hand, and I'm sure you've heard of the Oedipus complex and the basic idea is that everything is driven by the sexual urge, all the way down to behavioral therapy, which only values what you do and how you change what you do. There's existential therapy, there's family therapy, there's a dozens in between. I'm gonna take a look at how three of those types of psychology can help us get a better understanding of Don Giovanni. The first one is going to be archetypal psychology. The second one is gonna be family systems therapy. And the third is going to be the model or one of the models of sex addiction, which is its own practice of clinical psychotherapy and actually follows several theoretical models, but we'll come back to that. Let us jump right in then to archetypal psychology. Actually, before we get there, are there any questions about the overall terrain of what we're going to be doing right now, where we are and where we are headed?
Hey, Paul, I just wondered, would you give us just a little overview of the storyline of the opera? What kind of happens?
Yes.
Are you going to do that? Okay.
Yes, I am. In fact, that's what I'm going to do right now. The story of the opera, to tell in all its detail, would take me about 10 minutes. So I'm going to summarize it very, very briefly in terms of the important characters that are in the opera. The protagonist of the opera is Don Giovanni. He's a nobleman in Seville. And what he wants more than anything, in fact, almost exclusively, is to seduce women and get them into bed. He has an assistant named Leporello, whose job it is to help Don Giovanni perpetrate a variety of tricks on people and to run Don Giovanni's castle and put out feasts for him. The first woman that we encounter is Donna Anna, who is also of the nobility class. And at the very beginning of the opera, we see Don Giovanni come running out of Donna Anna's home. She's chasing after him. She screams and then runs off. Her father, the commendatore, arrives and Don Giovanni kills him. And then they take off. Next, Don Giovanni and Leporello are going along and they encounter Donna Elvira. Donna Elvira is somebody whom Don Giovanni has already seduced and then disappeared on. He promised her he would love her, he would marry her, he would be with her forever. He split as soon as possible. He hopes not to be recognized by her, but then she recognizes him and then he weasels his way out of that and away he goes. Next, Leporello and Don Giovanni run across an engagement party. Zerlina and Macedo are going to get married. Into the midst of the engagement party, Don Giovanni has Leporello take Macedo away off to his castle, and Don Giovanni begins to seduce Zerlina. And this, over the course of the opera, makes Macedo incredibly jealous. Then we come to the second act, in which everybody is slowly figuring out who is Don Giovanni and what he's up to. And everybody begins to recognize who he is. The culminating scene of the opera is where he invites everyone to a big party and he tries to physically drag Zerlina into another room. He actually does that. And then he tries to rape her and she screams, everybody rushes in. Don Giovanni very stealthily sneaks out the back door, comes in the side door, draws his sword and points it at Leporello and says, what are you doing, you guy? What's going on? But nobody believes this. But then they sneak out anyways. Finally, in the end, Don Giovanni is having his own massive feast. He's sitting there. Leporello is gorging him on wine and on food. And Don Giovanni does not give him a crumb. So Leporello is sneaking pheasant wings off the table and trying to eat while he's serving him. Elvira comes in and says, you really should repent. Which is a message that Leporello has given him also. Leporello says, you know, this is such a bad idea all the time. Don Giovanni steadfastly refuses to repent. And then the statue of the commendatore who Don Giovanni killed in the first few minutes of the opera comes to life, comes to the dinner and says, Don Giovanni, I invited you to dinner. Now you come to dinner. And Don Giovanni says, you come to my dinner. And the statue says, no, you come to my dinner. And Don Giovanni very cavalierly says, okay, I will. And then the gates of hell open up and it's staged differently in different ways. But generally what you see is Don Giovanni being dragged literally and symbolically down into the flames of hell. There's a number of side plots as well that have to do with the precise way in which Don Giovanni is discovered and how he's recognized and what else he does, including trying to seduce Leporello's wife while the two of them are dressed as each other as part of yet another trick that they're playing. So there we have the plot of the opera. Let's jump into archetypal psychology now. I'm gonna share my screen up. Share screen, and we are here, share. Are you guys seeing my title screen? Because I cannot find it. Just a moment, please.
Yes.
Technical. Aha. All right. Pardon me.
There it is.
There it is.
We have it now. Yeah.
The story is summarized in more detail in the slides. Okay, what are archetypes? As I mentioned when I spoke about the previous opera, archetypes, which were really discussed initially by Carl Jung and then subsequently by others, are universal patterns or motifs which come from the collective unconscious, which means we all share them, and are the basic content of religions, mythologies, legends, and fairy tales, emerging in individuals in the form of dreams, visions, and fantasies. And I would add also artistic productions such as operas. The archetype carries specific energy and is capable of acting upon the world. Another way to say that is archetypes are the very basic and fundamental and common images that all cultures share. For example, one such archetype is the puer. And the puer is the child, the immature adult. You may have heard about the hero's journey. Before the hero goes on the hero's journey, he is the puer. And some argue that Don Giovanni is an archetype of the puer, that the way he is acting is in fact just childlike. He sees something or someone that he wants, and he takes it without any regard for the other person, without any regard for the consequences, only to satisfy his own wishes. Another archetype, which is a little bit more complex, is the persona. And the persona is an archetype which is defined as mediating between ourselves, our ego, whatever it is that we experience inside us as being authentically us, and the rest of the world outside. And oftentimes the persona is compared to a mask. And the reason why I would say that Don Giovanni is identified so strongly with the archetype of the persona is that in many ways, he's all mask and no self. He's so full of pretending to be this or that or the other someone in order to accomplish his goal of getting women into bed, that there's no there inside there, only the mask. let me give you a few examples. The very first thing that he says in the opera, which is to Donna Anna, who's screaming because he's just entered her bedroom without permission and tried to get into bed with her. He says, "Madwoman, your shouting is in vain. You'll never discover who I am." Now, what are the implications of this? The first thing is he first shows up literally with a mask on and also disguised. You don't see the real Don Giovanni at first, possibly ever. Secondly, throughout the course of the opera, a great deal of energy is spent trying to figure out who is behind that mask. Donna Anna doesn't know who he is. And after he kills Donna Anna's father, the commendatore, she vows vengeance. And the first thing that she needs to do in order to avenge her father is figure out who the bad guy was. The next thing is that when she starts to make a commotion, he seems genuinely distraught that Donna Anna might actually want to know who is behind the mask. He seems shocked that she's making such a fuss about the whole thing. And he doesn't like that she is making a commotion. And the reason why I believe he doesn't like that she's making a commotion is that the more people who are present with Don Giovanni at any one time, the more likely it is that they will put two and two and two together and discern who he actually is. So he wishes she would just shut up and he could get out of there, which is in fact what happens. With one exception, she makes her fiance, Don Ottavio, promise that he will help in getting vengeance on Don Giovanni. And that comes into play later on, okay? Another example, Don Giovanni comes across Donna Elvira, and she is distraught because she has been left by her lover. And he doesn't recognize her at first, and she doesn't recognize him at first. So rather than disappear, he takes on a role. This time, the very ironic role of consoler. His wish is to go console her, which is perhaps euphemistic for, once again, get her into bed. And so when he says, "I really want to console her," we understand that it's got two meanings there. Previously, he had assumed the role of her husband. She responds to this by assigning him other roles. "You're a bad guy, you're a demon, you're evil." And Leporello's response to the whole situation is to comment on the different roles that she is assigning him. Look how she describes him. Look what kind of roles she's giving him. So rather than an actual interchange between the two people, there's this pretense, and then there's this counter-identification, and then there's Leporello commenting on the game that they are playing. Meanwhile, Leporello says, "It sounds like she read it from a book." And one way to understand this is that Leporello understands not just Don Giovanni, but everyone to be acting within a prescribed role. Don Giovanni did something, Donna Elvira responds, and both what he did and how she responds are prescribed by some book that's out there. Alternatively, and this brings us to another example, Leporello carries around a book, a big fat book. And into this book, whenever Don Giovanni beds somebody, they write an entry in the book. And Leporello, either because he feels bad for Donna Elvira, or because he's very cruel and sadistic, and different people argue different things. He tells her, "You really should not go with that guy. All he ever does is try to sleep with people. Here, let me tell you." And he summarizes the course of the book. And as it turns out, he summarizes it country by country. There's 1,003 in Spain and 90 something in Turkey, et cetera. It adds up to more than 2,000 people. And so it's clear that Don Giovanni is locked into a particular role. It's also the case that Leporello indicates that Don Giovanni has specific masks that he uses for specific reasons in order to get specific kinds of people into bed. So Leporello says during, it's called the catalog scene, he says with blondes, he praises their sweetness. With brunettes, he praises their constancy. With old people, he praises their tenderness. And so you get a sense that Don Giovanni's carrying around all these little masks. Oh, there's a blonde person. Oh, you're so sweet, aren't you? So I love that. Oh, a brunette. You are so marvelously constant. I admire you more than anyone. Oh, an old person. Oh, what a sweet woman. Come here, come here, come here. If you're wondering why it is that anyone has any sympathy for Don Giovanni, given our current sensibilities, I would like to offer a comparison. Okay, let's see. I'm gonna stop my share and then I'm gonna restart it with the sound and everything. Advanced. And let's have this one share. Okay, and let us go back down to this. I think you may be familiar with some of this material.
Woman beg, and I make a good woman steal. I make an old woman blush, and I make a young girl squeal. And I'm here to tell you, honey, that I'm bad to the bone, bad to the bone, bad, 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 bad,
So we understand that Don Giovanni might be a scoundrel in the same way that we understand that the singer in Bad to the Bone might be a scoundrel. Nonetheless, with the power chords, which is to say with the musicality that accompanies each or both, and also with the cultural values that some people assign to it, this scoundrel is in fact quite a hero, or at least quite a type of a hero. And we'll look more into that later on. Okay, now, I want to. One other way to consider Don Giovanni archetypally, which comes from this, is radically different. Some would say that Don Giovanni's purpose, especially in contrast to the commendatori, is to be a symbol of life, liberty, and vitality. And he wants to share his life and share or take, as the case may be, his liberty with everyone and share his vitality with everyone. So in that regard, Don Giovanni is life and the commendatory signifies death. Don Giovanni is action and the commendatory is words. Don Giovanni is strong and powerful and effective, and the commendatore is old and weak and doddering and ineffective. Don Giovanni is consumed with living. When he's not trying to seduce somebody, what he's most often doing is either eating or feeding someone. And what he neglects to do oftentimes is feed Leporello. And so he's really parceling out life everywhere, 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 except where it's most important. And some people would say that Don Giovanni is in fact not meant to be understood as a complete character or as a full human. If you have read the play Othello, you may have noticed that Othello is powerfully naive, and it's hard to understand why he does what he does. And Iago is powerfully conniving and malicious. It's hard to understand why he does what he does. But if you look at Othello and Iago as part of two parts of one thing, then it begins to make sense. So here we have Don Giovanni as unrestrained life force and Leporello as grounded common sense. Another example of that pattern, by the way, is Pinocchio and Jiminy Cricket. We have foolish, boyish energy and prudence and common sense. Neither one is a full human. Together, they make more of a human. Finally, in the area of archetypal psychology, I want to read you something by the Danish philosopher, Soren Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard heard Don Giovanni and he really went nuts. He loved the opera. He was infatuated with the opera. He wrote extensively about the opera, and he had some really amazing, some of them quite bizarre things to say about the opera. But I want to read something that Kierkegaard had to say in this vein. Share screen. Let's see here. Okay, Kierkegaard said, the hero, Don Giovanni, is also the force in the other characters. His passion sets in motion the passion of the others. His passion resonates everywhere. It resonates in and supports the commendatore's earnestness, Elvira's wrath, Anna's hate, Ottavio's pomposity, Zerlina's anxiety, Mazzetto's indignation, Leporello's confusion. Kierkegaard also said, and this is really quite interesting, because notice that rather than giving a literary analysis, he's actually analyzing the musical structures themselves, but making the same point. The overture is powerful like a god's idea, turbulent like a world's life, harrowing in its earnestness, palpitating in its desire, crushing in its terrible wrath, animating in its full-blooded joy. It is hollow-toned in judgment, shrill in lust. It is ponderous, ceremonious in its awe, inspiring dignity. It is stirring, flaring, and daring in its insight. To anyone hearing the overture after he has become more familiar with the opera, it may seem as if he has penetrated the hidden workshop where the forces he has learned to identify in the opera move with a primitive power, where they wrestle with one another with all their might. He's talking about the conflict between life and death. The contest, however, is too uneven. Before the battle, one force is already the victor. It flees and escapes, but this flight is precisely its passion, its burning restlessness in its brief joy of life, the pounding pulse in its passionate ardor. It thereby sets the other force in motion. So bear in mind that Kierkegaard is starting this experience with his experience of the overture. He goes on to say that, in fact, when he watches the opera, he prefers to get the cheapest seats possible. And if possible, he'd rather stand in the alleyway outside because he finds the words to be distracting to the themes which are contained in the music. So this is not literary analysis. This is, in fact, subjective musical analysis. Before we go on, then, I would just like to ask, are there any questions about what we've gotten so far? Any questions about the archetypal psychology piece of it, or anything else? Sorry about that. Are there any questions about what we've got so far? The archetypal psychology piece or anything that we've hit so far? Stick your thumb up, raise your hand, pop it into the chat, or hold on to it and save it for later. Okay, let us move on then to family systems theory. Family systems theory, if you're not familiar with it, is a very different kind of psychology than Freudian psychotherapy or even other individual therapies that you may be aware of, because it understands health in a different way. Family systems theory views the basic unit of health as a family, or in this context, as a system of people. And rather than looking at psychopathology like character disorders or psychoses or addictions or impulse disorders, these are all examples of psychopathologies, family systems theory looks at the way in which the people in the family interact and whether they're interacting in a healthy way or whether they're interacting in an unhealthy way. Family systems theory has an idea, which is that of the identified patient, which means that some of the time in a particular family, somebody will appear to have a psychological or a behavioral problem. And that person is known in the industry as the IP, or the identified patient. And family systems theory doesn't seek to fix the IP. Family systems theory seeks to figure out what is going on in the family that enables, allows, causes, perpetuates the IP being the IP. So rather than asking the question, what's wrong with this person, they might ask the question, well, how does what this person does affect the family and vice versa? But they're not so hung up on fixing an individual problem. One of the earliest family theorists was a guy named Bowen, and he articulated 8 different criteria of the healthy family. And I will tell you what those are. They're listed in the slides, but I will just tell you. The first one is that individuals within a family are individuated as opposed to being enmeshed, which is a way of saying they're their own person. They don't blend into each other, okay? Secondly, the family values mutuality versus isolation. Each person in the family is contributing to the same effort as opposed to each person being fragmented or isolated or locked out. The family should be flexible rather than rigid. The family should be stable rather than disorganized. This family should have clear perceptions rather than distorted perceptions. The family should have clear rather than unclear communication. The family should have role reciprocity as opposed to unclear roles or role conflict, which is to say it should be clear and also a little bit fluid who does what, how. It should not be unclear, and it should not cause problems all the time. And then finally, the family should have clear versus diffused or breached generational boundaries. Now, if you're a parent or if you're familiar with how they teach parenting, you may have heard the idea that the parents always agree with each other. That's layperson's language for clear versus diffused or breached generational boundaries. The point is that the marital dyad, the parents, should be one unit, and the kids should be a different unit, and that the power dynamic should go this way, not this way. It also has to do with the way in which the grandparents affect the system. So those are the main criteria. Now, we could spend several months unpacking Don Giovanni and seeing how the various characters rank or compare really against these different criteria. I'm only going to take on one or two for the sake of time. The first one I'm going to look at is individuation versus enmeshment. Are the characters individuated? Do they stand on their own? Or are they somehow enmeshed? Are they too involved with each other? Okay. First point, Don Giovanni doesn't respect physical boundaries. When it comes to families, one of the signs of enmeshment is that the doors aren't clearly open or closed or locked or unlocked, and people are in and out of each other's bedrooms all the time. The kids in the parents' bedroom, the parents in the kids' bedroom, the kids in each other's bedrooms. This is an example of enmeshment. So Don Giovanni, extremely so, has no respect for anybody's bedroom. At the very beginning of the opera, he has already waltzed uninvited into somebody else's bedroom. He intrudes on Donna Anna's space. He attempts to rape Zerlina. And he also is lurking about in other people's gardens throughout the course of the opera. He also doesn't respect relational boundaries. I would point out that some of the examples I'll give, you might slot into other categories, and that's okay. There's different ways to understand them. He claims that he will marry Donna Elvira, and then he vanishes. So he's neither solidly there nor solidly gone, because once he sees her again, he tries to get her back, and then he leaves again. Even more strikingly, Zerlina and Mazzetto are engaged. They're celebrating that. They're literally on the precipice of getting married, and he says, Leporello, take all these people to my castle and give them a bunch of wine and food. I want to sleep with her, right? So he's got no respect for the boundaries of relationship. But, and this is important, and this is why family systems theory has something different to offer than other theories, it's not just Don Giovanni who has difficulty with boundaries. And there are others who are complacent in the enmeshment, okay? Don Giovanni does not do what he does without Leporello's assistant. And what's interesting is that Leporello complains consistently, literally from the first moment of the opera till the very last moment of the opera. You shouldn't do this. This is terrible. This is the worst kind of job. I don't want to be here. I want another boss. He goes on and on about how bad it is, but he takes no direct action to stop it. He tries to confront Don Giovanni near the beginning of the opera, but Don Giovanni shuts him down so quickly and so effectively and so manipulatively that Leporello really never takes an active stance against it. There are also two, what I call profoundly masochistic gestures in the opera. And I would like to read one of them to you. One of them is Donna Elvira near the end of the opera. And she says to Don Giovanni, basically, despite all the horrible things that you have done to me,
I still love you, right? Which is, in modern parlance, a very codependent thing to say. Zerlina is even more masochistic sounding to me. Her problem is that as Don Giovanni has been trying to seduce her, her fiance has been getting jealous because from what he sees, every time he turns around, Don Giovanni is alone with Zerlina. And he gets really angry. And so she says to him this. I think I shared the wrong screen. Are you guys getting my slides now?
Mm-hmm. We're still on the outline.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I shared the wrong screen. Pardon. Okay, Macedo believes that Zerlina has been unfaithful to him. And Zerlina says to Macedo, "Don't you believe me? Ungrateful, come here, strike me, kill me, do anything you please to me. But then, my dear Macedo, then let's be friends again. Beat me, dear Macedo, beat your poor Zerlina. I'll stand here like a little lamb awaiting your blows. I'll let you pull my hair out. I'll let you tear my eyes out. And even then, I'll kiss your dear hands." So in this instance, it is not Don Giovanni who is being enmeshed. It is two totally other characters. Zerlina allowing Macedo to intrude upon her. So if we understand this as an aspect of the system, it seems like everybody is free to totally intrude upon everybody else. And Don Giovanni is able to do what he does because of that characteristic of the system. Okay, there we have family systems theory. Are there any questions about that component of things, family systems theory, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera? All right, then, let us move along to our third point of view, or our third way of looking at things, which is this idea of sex addiction. Okay. The first thing to know is that depending on whom you ask, sex addiction either exists or does not exist. And what I mean by that is that the official book of books in the United States is a book called the DSM, and it's revised every few years. So right now we're in the DSM-5, the fifth revision. Just for context, when I graduated graduate school about 15, 20 years ago, we were in the DSM-3. So you can see about every 6-7-ish years, they revise it. Why do they revise it? Because psychologists come to a different understanding of what psychological conditions are, how they relate to each other, more and more what causes them and what are the neurological underpinnings of them and what legitimately constitute a condition. For example, in earlier editions of the DSM, homosexuality was a psychopathology. It was a wrong state of mind and it was therefore treatable. This is no longer the case because the society has a different understanding of that. Any number of things have changed. If you look at diagnoses like autism and Asperger's. Those come and go and are reorganized and re-reorganized continuously. And the point I'm making about sex addiction is that it does not exist in the DSM-5. Now, some people would say, many would say, that that doesn't mean anything, because the primary use of the DSM-5 is to satisfy bureaucrats and insurance providers, people who fund things or have to pay back for things. They want to know what the diagnostic code they're treating is. But it has little to do, or not too much to do, with what actually goes on for people. It is also the case that whether or not sex addiction is in the DSM-5, there are plenty of clinicians who believe that there is sex addiction, who are actively treating sex addiction. And there is a similar book, which is called the ICD, which is published by the World Health Organization. So it's got a similar function, except it's used by people around the world. It's now in its 11th revision. And the ICD does recognize sex addiction. And being the kind of book that it is, it characterizes it as being an impulse disorder, which at times hyperactivity has been characterized as, or other conditions. So that's how they think about it. Meanwhile, in the same way that there is Alcoholics Anonymous, and the DSM does recognize alcohol abuse and alcoholism as psychological conditions, there is also Sex Addicts Anonymous, regardless of what the DSM has to say. And they describe sex addiction in terms of their experience of it. Let me read you the description of what the ICD has to say about sex addiction. And let us think whether or not these things apply to Don Giovanni. Okay. It's described as compulsive sexual behavior and characterized by a persistent pattern of failure to control intense, repetitive sexual impulses or urges resulting in repetitive sexual behavior. Symptoms may include repetitive sexual activities becoming a central focus of the person's life to the point of neglecting health and personal care or other interests, activities, and responsibilities. Numerous unsuccessful efforts to significantly reduce repetitive sexual behavior, and continued repetitive sexual behavior despite adverse consequences or deriving little or no satisfaction from it, manifested over an extended period of time, such as 6 months or more. They go on to say, this pattern causes marked distress or significant impairment in personal affairs, family life, social life, your educational life, your occupational life, or other important areas of functioning. They go on to say, distress that is entirely related to moral judgments and disapproval about sexual impulses, urges, or behaviors is not sufficient to meet this requirement. And they point out that you need to distinguish between sex addiction and what are called the paraphilic disorders, or what Freud called fetishes, or what modern individuals call kink. You have to tease out, is the person a pervert, or is the person a sex addict? It's this use of the word pervert, by the way, is why some people say that there should not be the diagnosis of sex addiction, because we tend to confuse this last sentence with everything else and lay our moral judgments on the client, when it's really not about moral judgment, it's about addictive, impulsive behavior. So now, for the last slide I want to take a look at, is I want to put up this chart in list format and see whether we can gain any insight about Don Giovanni's behavior from it. Okay, You can all see the list, yes? And I'm not muted, correct? Good. Okay. Repetitive, I've marked all these things as either a check, which means yes, it applies, an X, which means no, it does not apply, or a tilde. Maybe. Repetitive sexual activities, check, repetitive, central. We can see that. Okay. To the point of neglecting his health. Maybe. He eats and drinks an awful lot, but is it too much? Maybe. It is linked to his exploits, and he is currently in good health. So you can see that because he so ably kills the commendatore and runs around through the course of the entire opera. Okay. It also, does it impede his ability to enjoy other activities? Well, no. He actually knows a great deal about music, about contemporary dance. He can talk about them. He can demand excellent performances. So no, it doesn't. And shirking his responsibilities. We don't know. Don Giovanni is extraordinarily affluent and he doesn't really have any responsibilities. The only responsibility he might have would be to say that he's responsible to be a good boss to Leporello. And he is a mediocre boss to Leporello. Leporello complains all the time and Don Giovanni does not fix anything, but he's constantly buying Leporello off. He's given him a little extra change here or there, okay? Let's look what else he's got. Numerous unsuccessful attempts to reduce behavior does not apply. It's never been a problem to him and he's never tried to fix it. Continued behavior despite adverse consequences. Yes, he murders somebody as a direct result of his behavior. It doesn't cause him to stop. Gets no satisfaction from it. I believe that's one way to interpret the catalog scene, is that he's so eager to bed people that he gets no joy out of anything. This is why he has to create a record, almost to persuade himself that it was worth the effort and that he had a good time. Personal distress, none. Family distress, yes. Don Giovanni does not have a family. He's got no wife, no kids, no parents, obvious, that he's in connection with. And the one person who might have been his wife, because he promised to be her husband, Dona Elvira, he has bailed on. So it certainly shows that his behavior impacts his ability to have a family. Social impact, yes, everybody wants to kill him. Educational, doesn't apply, we don't know. Occupational, as I said before, he's mediocre boss to Leporello, and other important areas of functioning, yes. Whether it's literal or metaphorical, the consequence in a big way of Don Giovanni's behavior is that death in the form of the commendatore comes to get him. And that is another important area of functioning. He cannot live because of what he has done. We have, I'm glad to say as long as you've got, and I think we have five-ish minutes to answer any questions that people have. I see that there are some things down in the chat. So let me take a peek and see if those are questions. And then if you want to raise your hands or just type them into the chat, let me know. Okay. Did Mozart write his opera in honor and in memory of Leopold? I don't know the answer to that question, but I suspect not. Don Giovanni is a one example of a legend, the Don Juan legend, which has existed in many iterations throughout history with three major ones and several sort of folk stories. So I don't think that it has a personal connection to the history of the time. A good question, as it's how it's presented in the movie Amadeus, lost track of which particular thing. I've read various theories. Let's see what Paul thinks at the end. My own personal opinion, the one that resonates most strongly with me, is the archetypal notion that Don Giovanni is all persona and no substance. He's all faker, and there's no real him inside there. Okay, my sound is gone. I hope it's back now. Oh, never mind. Okay. All examples of the puer. I don't quite understand that comment. Does somebody want to hear more examples of it? Or just pointing out that pretty much everything he does is childlike. It's immediate. It's for physical and sensual gratification. It's to feed himself, either physically or sexually. In that regard, he is the puer. Okay. Are we supposed to see the Kierkegaard slide? Yes, I think I worked that out. Okay. Ta-da. How is he supposed to be friends after he kills her? Just to clarify, Don Giovanni doesn't kill any women in the play. He kills the commendatore, who is the father of Donna Anna. And he attempts to rape Zerlina, but he doesn't murder any women during the course of the opera.
I believe that comment was in regard to the conversation they had where she said that he could do as he pleases. And one of the things she had mentioned was kill her.
Yeah. Oh, that her.
Yeah.
Well, it's important to know that after she says that, he doesn't do it. And she says, see, I knew you couldn't bring yourself to do it. So I don't think that she ever expects that he will, but she's sort of symbolically offering herself up as a sacrificial lamb. Like, oh, you're mad at me? Okay, hit me, hit me, hit me. Which is a masochistic dynamic, but I don't believe that she actually expects to be hit or killed by him. If she did, that would be truly tragic. I mean, I find it to be perhaps the most disturbing, or one of the most disturbing moments in the opera, but I don't think that she intends for him to actually do it. Okay, let's see. Will he be friends with a corpse? I'm not sure if this question is tongue in cheek, but a number of things that I read talk about this underlying theme, which I haven't talked too much about at all, about death in the opera. And throughout history, including now, the notion of somebody being dead and then coming back alive was very common. There are a number of different operas or folk stories or other stories about this. And so it's a little bit less surprising that this corpse or this statue of the commendatore should in fact come after Don Giovanni. It was explained to me that that is why people are buried or cremated. It's both a ritual of respect. It's also to ensure that the bodies cannot come back up out of the earth or as one piece and come get you. Okay. Are these characters not just aspects of Mozart's inner self or his self? That is an excellent question. I would say, yes, they probably are. Mozart not only wants you to watch the opera and hear the opera, but he also wants you to know that he, Mozart, created it. And he wants you to be thinking that while you're watching that. How do we know? In the very last scene, the musical accompaniment is a piece from The Marriage of Figaro, one of the operas that Mozart just recently wrote. And some commentators say, well, why would Mozart put a Mozart opera in a Mozart opera? And the answer to that is, so everyone thinks, oh, Mozart the composer. Oh, Mozart the composer. And have that moment of Mozart's direct hand in the opera. And by extension, Mozart's psyche in the opera. And if you know about his biography and or if you have watched Amadeus, they're not exactly the same, but significantly so, you can see how Mozart was quite the puer. He was very childlike in many regards. And he manifested that through many aspects of his life. I happen to believe, second opinion, that much art, if not most art, if not all art, reflects the inner state of the artist, unless they diligently are working hard for it not to, or unless they are ineptly unable to do so. But in the vast majority of instances, that is the case, which is why whenever I do certain art pieces and I show them to friends, I say, oh, it's a self-portrait, regardless of what it is, because in a certain sense, it's always a self-portrait. So I would venture to say from that point of view, yes, Don Giovanni is about Mozart and about aspects of Mozart's self. Okay. The subtitle said that 15, 20 years ago as when you graduated, that was 15 or 20 years ago, not 1520 years ago. I'm not that old. Okay, let's see here. This is not a question. I just wanted to say that it's interesting that Giovanni's behavior is analyzed to this extent. And it's very interesting to hear. Whoever wrote that, just the tip of the iceberg. Just the tip of the iceberg. If you look back at the slides, you'll see what went on the cutting room floor that I didn't get to. And you'll see the bibliography of the lengthy articles which take individual sentences that I had and had whole papers on them, and a whole slew of points of view that I didn't hit. They're the people who talk about the way in which the arias and the recitatives are used differently in Don Giovanni than in other operas. And that is a signification of a certain kind of musical enmeshment, and on and on and on. There are literally entire papers on the function and symbolism of the descending fourth in the opera. And those are the musical ones. There was another one about the key of D minor in the opera and what it signifies. Mozart tended to assign certain keys to certain themes. And so you can actually listen to the follow, track the keys as they go through the opera and see which characters they attach to, which themes they attach to. So I'm glad you enjoyed it. And there's a lot more than I was able to give over tonight. What do we got? What Charbonneswitch is the word? That was a joke. Okay. What I said about 15 to 20. All right, I think I've got all the questions in the chat. Are there any more questions that anybody has?
I have one for you. And actually, we have to get somewhat tied up here. But to go back to the representations of the characters in the opera, what do you think about the statue? Do you think that's an internal judgment that the statue represents, or do you think the statue is an external?
I think that it is external, although plenty of people think that it's internal. The Freudians would like to say, and I skipped over that, that the statue represents Don Giovanni's sense of guilt about what he's done. And that's why there's conflict between Don Giovanni and the commendatore at the beginning. That's where this conflict begins. And then eventually the guilt overwhelms him and pulls him out of life. That's not nearly as satisfying to me as the fact that Don Giovanni is sort of an unreconstructed jerk. And the powers that be come to get him, even though he is asked twice in the preceding 5 minutes, wouldn't you rather change your mind? Throughout the course of the opera, there's this dance of lightness and darkness. And then just about at that moment, the dance of light and dark switches to the dance of hot and cold. Leporello gets a fever. The room becomes warmer. And my take on that is literally within the context of the opera, hell is getting closer and the doors are opening. And Dona Elvira arrives and says as compassionately as possible, please, despite the fact that you've been such a knucklehead before and that I really ought to hate you, I just pity you, but change your ways or you will burn. You know, it's the big, not only have I told you so, but I am telling you so right this minute. And you've got about 10 seconds to change your mind. And he does not, which is why I like to believe that the statue is external. It's the powers that be confronting a guy like him.
All right. Thank you, Paul. Great lecture. It was really interesting to hear the three prisms of looking at this. And I'm sure you have a lot more on all
Thank you.
Of that.
If anyone has any further questions, please feel free to email me.
So there is quite a bit of chatter here in the chat. They would like to know what their code word is for tonight. And usually what I ask people is, what is their favorite dessert? And so do you have a favorite dessert, Paul?
My favorite dessert. Let's see. It comes and it goes, but at the moment, this particular second, I would say bread pudding.
Bread pudding is Correct. The code word. There you go, everybody. That'll get you your points. All right. Well, I'm going to stick around here for a while. If anyone has any questions, I'm happy to help out with that. And Paul, if you'd like to, you can as well. If you need to go, that's all.
No, awesome. I'm Thank glad you. To stay around.
Okay, and a big applause for Paul Epstein. Wonderful lecture tonight, and very interesting, and thank you for
Thank all you all very much for your interest and your attention.
I have a question for Paul.
Yes.
Hi, so I know that you're a psychologist, and that's kind of what I'm trying to get into with child psychology. Is it hard to watch things like this and not kind of like associate it with your career at all or anything like that?
I just want to clarify, for ethical sake, I'm not technically a psychologist. I have a master's degree in clinical psychology. The difference being that you, it's not your bad, it's my responsibility. That you have to do a certain number of hours to earn a license, and I got the degree. I never finished doing the hours. I don't have the license. I tend to do it, but I think that is endemic to me, not to the profession. I once, when I was in college, did a lecture series. We invited a math professor to come give a talk. And we asked him about laserium shows. And we said, when you look at those things, are you thinking of what the formulas are that drive those weird shapes? And he says, I try not to let math intrude onto everything, right? So same way as me. Personally, Jung talks about this. There are different typologies. Some people are thinky. Some people are feely. Some people are sensate. Some people are intuitive. I can get thinky, but sometimes it gets in the way of directly experiencing an opera or any other piece of art. So I try not to be. I wouldn't worry about it. If you're not already that way, then I don't think becoming a psychologist would make you be that way. And if you already do lean that way, then it's enjoyable to me, you know? So somebody else might say, oh, you're intellectualizing. You know, you're taking away from the work. It's a way in which I connect with the material.
Can I offer my perspective on this?
Certainly. Okay. Introduce yourself and say your background.
I am Paul's daughter, and I'm majoring in psychology at Tulane, and I'm graduating in May. And I also want to go into child psych. And I think my dad, because of his background in psychology, does have a tendency to make most of the times when we're watching movies or other medias, he does often offer a psychological perspective. But I also think that people who naturally think about the psychological perspective are more drawn into going into the field of psychology, which is also another reason why those types of people would just tend to analyze any opera or movie or song that was put in front of them. And I have a tendency to do it too. And is it because I'm majoring in psychology and interested in it? Or is it because I grew up with such a psychological father?
Other comments? Thank you. That was a very interesting question.
I appreciate your input, and you guys have a good night. Thank you.
You too.
Night.
Thanks, Megan. A psychological father.
Yeah.
Sounds a little ominous.
And a psychological mother. They're both
very. I was going to point out there's more players in this game.
Yeah. No, it's all of us, really.
Well, you guys could just sit around and psychoanalyze things. And...
We do. Seriously. We sit around and psychoanalyze each other. And
that must make for a great conversation.
If next year you would like to, instead of opera, take on banjo music, do a great piece about deliverance.
I may invite the whole family next time.
That would be funny.
Yeah. Crossfire. Oh, wow. Oh, we have...
I have a question for Paul. Hey, Paul, that was a really great lecture. Thanks a lot for that.
Thank you.
I was really captured by the image of the statue, the commendatore. Yeah, so sort of like
commandant.
The frozen father being killed off right at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Is how I sort of interpret it, and like Elvira sort of being like the bad mother. And I was kind of hearing it all almost like the quaternity of the self, you know, like the undeveloped ego, and
right.
Then you have like the anima is kind of how I was seeing it. But I was just wondering if you thought that maybe Mozart, maybe his like dying early, sort of like a puer, was his like failed initiation into the father archetype, you know, because he died like 4 years right after his father had died.
Right. That could very well be the case. The remark that I made about that the hero starts out as the puer and then becomes the hero, the transition, as you point out, is the initiation. And it's possible that despite his successes, Mozart never viewed himself as either being thoroughly tested or thoroughly approved of. And for that reason, he remained a puer, and that then carries over into Don Giovanni, and it makes sense to me then that he would be slain by the critical father figure. So it does make sense to me.
Interesting. Yeah, thanks a lot. I appreciate your lecture for tonight.
Sure. Thank you.
All right. It's just
Alrighty.
Us.
It's just us.
Traubs and me.
Yeah, you can come out of hiding. There's nobody else here.
They went to get ice cream.
Did they? That's funny. All right. Well, thank you very much. And
thank you, Paul. It was awesome, as always. And it was very informative. And it's great because you have a real way of connecting with people who these kinds of topics are, I would imagine, for most of the people that were here tonight were fairly new. And that's, you have a great way of bringing that to a level of
thank you.
Interest.
Yeah, everyone. It was fun. They definitely seemed engaged with it. And
some of them really into it.
That's
really wonderful. And as I've been going through the series, trying to get people from all different sort of viewpoints and experiences, and this was a very nice one for them. So thank you.
Are you going to do it again in the fall, or
does it? I am thinking about it because it's been pretty successful. So at least in my opinion, it's been successful because I don't really get to do things in depth with students in this way. I teach these sort of general music appreciation and general history classes. And so you don't get to really go into one topic very deeply. Mm-hmm. So this has been a lot of fun. And I think for them too, they get a somewhat of a little graduate seminar and something. And they've become very interested in this one in particular, I think because of the movie Amadeus, it was just kind of a lightning. That's fun. And then that really piques a lot of questions. So anyway, I'm thinking about it. So now I have to really think about what would be good to go with next.
And I'll give you some ideas.
Okay. Would love it. You gave me some ideas before. Appreciate it. You guys have a great night, and thanks again. And I'll talk to you soon. And let me know if you need any help with your move. I'm happy to pitch in.
Thank you. The first thing we need is to finish putting cabinets into the new house. And then we'll have a place to put stuff.
Yeah. Well,
we're working on that.
It's a big project to move.
All right.
All right.
All right. Good night. I'll talk to you later.
All right. Bye-bye. Thank you.